Them a Muslim is that they testify that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah. So whoever comes to us now and says, what? Are you trying to say that the Prophet had blood of kufr in it? Then we say to you, where's your proof? First and foremost, to show that this person or this father or his mother was Muslim. Who can bring me a delil? A proof. Who can bring me a proof to show that Amina said
let me answer this point. Again, I'm going to use his own evidence to knock him out.
Now I heard you, you hear me now.
I don't wave my hands like you, but as good as you. But the thing is, you may be very good with your hands. But the fact of the matter is, I will now explain your own evidence against you. He says that the definition of a Muslim is he who says La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Yes, that applies to all those who are mukallif of the Sharia. Right, for example, from the Prophet ﷺ till the Day of Judgment, every human being is mukallif of the Sharia. True? Mukallif of the Sharia?
Yes.
From the Prophet ﷺ till the Day of Judgment?
Yes.
You're accepting this? But the Prophet's father wasn't even in his own time. He died 6 months before he passed away, before he was born. So how can he be mukallif of a Sharia when he was living at that time?
From the Prophet onwards.
So did Isa say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah?
No, he said, La ilaha illallah Isa.
So that means, according to your definition, you said every Muslim is a Muslim if he says, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah.
From the Sharia of Muhammad.
So that means, according to your formula, all those people who existed before the Prophet ﷺ, okay, in their Sharia, there was 500 years between Isa and the Prophet ﷺ. That means what he is saying, that in 500 years, Allah did not send a Prophet. For 500 years, there was no Muslim on the face of the earth, according to his definition. The fact of the matter is, a Muslim in the Ummah of the Prophet ﷺ is he who says, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, and a Muslim in the time before the Prophet ﷺ is he who says, La ilaha illallah. And as long as he says La ilaha illallah, he is a Muslim. We cannot deny his Islam. But if he was close to a Prophet, if he was in the time of the Prophet, if he was in the tribe the Prophet came from, then he must say La ilaha illallah, Isa Ruhullah, La ilaha illallah, Adam Safiullah. You cannot expect a person who wasn't in the tribe of Isa alayhi salam to accept his deen, because every Prophet came from a particular tribe. But as far as the Prophet is concerned, he came for every tribe and every nation. But as far as the 500 year gap is concerned, there was no Sharia. So how the hell could they say Muhammad Rasulullah? So therefore, the Sharia between those 500 years was of La ilaha illallah.
Just regard this point where the Prophet says, I regard the situation where there is a period, a time period within the 500 years period or 600 years from the Isa till the time of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. What do we do with those people, i.e. who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala but never saw the Prophet? As regards with these people, there's a clear hadith which is sahih, in which the Prophet said that there's four people on the Yawm al-Qiyamah who will bring the case to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala: the deaf man, the senile man, the insane man, and the man who lived when there was no messenger. Now these four people on the Yawm al-Qiyamah, they will come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and each one will present their excuse. So the deaf man will say, oh Allah, I did not hear your message. The senile man will say, oh Allah, I could not understand your message. The man who was insane will say, oh Allah, your messenger came when the children threw dung at me. And the man who died in the period when there was no messenger will say, oh Allah, your messenger never came to me. Your messenger never came to me. So the testimony, the witness will be taken from these four people that they will believe in Allah. And then Allah will order them on that day to jump into the hellfire. And the Prophet swore by Allah, said, by him in whose hand is my soul, if they were to jump into the hellfire, it will become cool for them. So we have to understand two things. That first and foremost, from the Sharia aspect, there's a Sharia aspect of looking at something, and there's a way in which Allah himself looks at something. So as regards those individuals who believed in Allah, but they were in a time period when there was no messenger, then their case is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We would not say to those kind of people now that okay, they're in the hellfire or they're in the paradise, etc.
Okay,
However, from the Sharia point, and this is what I'm trying to make you brothers and sisters understand, from the Sharia point, i.e. what Allah has legislated for us human beings how to interact with each other, then Allah has given us certain principles in how to know this is a Muslim, that is a Kafir. So this man, he went to the Jews and he said to the Jews, "Oh Jew, I would like to become I would like to embrace your religion." And the Jew said to him, "You will not embrace our religion until you take your share of Allah's curse." And the man said, "I do not run except from Allah's curse, and I will not take any part of it as long as I'm able to. Can you tell me any other religion?" He said, "Yes, the religion of Hanifa, the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam." He said, "What is this Hanifa?" He said, "To worship Allah alone and not associate partners with him." Then he went to another place and he met a Christian. He said to the Christian, "Oh Christian, I'd like to embrace your religion. Tell me something about it." He said, "Do not embrace our religion until you take part in Allah's wrath, or you take a share of Allah's wrath." He said, "I do not run except from Allah's wrath, and I'll try and avoid it as much as I'm possible. Tell me another religion." And that man told him about the religion of Hanifa, exactly the same thing, the religion of Ibrahim, that he's going to worship Allah, that he used to worship Allah alone, and he was not of those who associated partners. So this man, he went to the Kaaba, and he raised his hand and said, "Oh Allah, I make you my witness. That I am upon the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam, i.e. to worship Allah alone." Which is what makes a Muslim, to worship Allah alone. However, this man died before the advent of prophethood and the prophethood. This man, according to the Sharia, is not a Muslim. Even though he made Allah his witness that he's upon the religion of Hanifa, even though he said that he's worshiping Allah alone and he's not a mushrik, this man, according to the Sharia, we cannot go to his grave and give him salam. And this is the issue.
Now you made the point. Let me just firstly answer you again, using your own evidence to knock you out. Now, as far as your first evidence is concerned, note his evidence. He said that the four people will come to Allah, and Allah will, in accordance with his own will and desire, forgive them. This is his statement. Now, if Allah will forgive the fourth category upon whom no prophet came, if Allah will forgive the fourth category upon whom no prophet had come, and the prophet swears that even hellfire, which is fire, will become cool, that means Allah will elevate the azab from that person because the prophet didn't come. If this is his judgment from that hadith, so then what about the prophet's father, who came at a time when prophethood wasn't announced, when there was no concept of Muhammad Rasulullah? If Allah can accept their forgiveness, and if Allah can forgive them, can't he forgive the can't he accept the iman of the Prophet ﷺ's father and mother? But the fundamental crux of his point is this, that he will measure everybody in the past according to the Sharia which we have. Is that your point?
Correct.
He's nodding. We all know he's nodding. Okay? He's nodding that he will judge everybody in the past according to the Sharia of the Prophet. You sure you're not going to change it? Are you sure?
Now.
Without a doubt, he says. Right, now, the fact of the matter is that he says that he's going to judge everybody according to the Sharia. But may I tell you, my dear brother, that there are certain things in our Sharia which are forbidden today that weren't forbidden in the previous Sharia. For example, incest is forbidden today. But it wasn't forbidden for the sons and daughters of Adam alayhi salam. Are you going to say their sons and daughters were committed incest? No. Why? Because incest was allowed in the Sharia of Adam alayhi salam. According to your formula, you are now saying that Adam alayhi salam's sons and daughters are incestuous. Why are you nodding your head? He just nodded. On the contrary.
No.
So therefore, no. Therefore, Islam and Iman have the same concept. You cannot say that a Muslim is only a Muslim if he says La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. A Muslim is a Muslim after the announcement of the Prophet ﷺ's Nabuwa, if he says La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. But before the time of the Prophet ﷺ and after the time of Isa alayhi salam, a person can only be a Muslim if he believes in La ilaha illallah. And that is exactly what I'm saying, is that there were mushrikeen around, but as far as the father and mother, you prove, and my challenge to the world of Salafiyyat is this: you're looking for proof, let me challenge you boys, that you tell me from any of your books or any of your things that the Prophet's father or the Prophet's mother ever committed the act of shirk. If you can prove that to me, then I will accept this.
Yes.
But you prove to me that they committed the act of shirk by saying anybody other than Allah. Their names demonstrated that they were Allah. And if according to his statement that everybody is universally Abdullah, then why did Islam come forth?
If everybody is Abdullah, why did Islam come for? Then there's no need for Islam if everybody is Abdullah. But the fact that Islam came, it wanted to differentiate hatta yamiz al-khabitha min al-sayyid. Allah wanted to differentiate from the pure and the impure. Are you going to say that a Muslim who is Abdullah is the same as Bill Clinton who is Abdullah? Shame on you. Now, back to the matter. They are Abdullah. What do you mean in control of Allah? That means they are in the control of Allah.
No.
Everybody is in the control of Allah.
No, there's two sides.
The fact of the matter is, you can only label water. You cannot label Coca-Cola water because it's not water. It's Coca-Cola.
Don't make the fact that
I am telling you, you cannot say to Tom De Bahari outside that you are Abdullah.
That's a false
thing.
Can you bring one narration here from the Salaf versus the Sahaba?
I know what the Salaf is, get on the question.
Can you bring from the Salaf, first of all, from the Sahaba, from the Tabi'een, or from the Asa'a Tabi'een, that Prophet Muhammad's family meaning, his father and his mother, are Muslim.
Yes.
And that, you won't enter Jahannam.
Yes.
Yeah, please, yeah.
Okay. Now, let me answer this. The rule of Munazah is, and the rule of all arguments and debate in the world is, he who asserts the point must justify it. They who said that he's a kafir, their justification for that assertion is that they didn't read La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. We are going to measure their iman or their Islam by virtue of the Sharia which we follow. But my argument to that is, how can you make them obliged to a Sharia which wasn't even evoked to them, which wasn't even expressed to them, which wasn't even in their time? So those people upon whom there was no Sharia, I am answering your question.
I'll ask you a question by name, is the individual from Quraysh before Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that there's a hadith saying that he's a kafir? There's a jinnah saying let me finish. We know before Islam, everyone is a kafir. So that's a general rule. So get him out from Islam,
Let me ask you this question. Do you believe or do you not believe that Allah knows your destiny? Does He know your destiny?
No.
He knows all. He knows what's going to happen to you. Everything. He knows about everyone. Does He or does He not?
No.
Well, if He knew Hazrat's mum and dad were going to die of coffee, why did He put him in there for? Why did she give birth to him?
He said to a man, where is my father? Your father is in hellfire. He died. He didn't say the word of Shahada. He's in hellfire. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has seen his face changing. He gets emotional, like other people get emotional. His father, how he say about my father's kafir? He gets emotional. Prophet, to make it easy for him, because he's rahmah for the people, he said to him, your father and your father are together. Your father and your father are together. The father of this Bedouin and my father, Brother Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, is together.
Fact of the matter.
Second hadith about his mother, when he asked my lord to go and visit my mother, which is 3 years. And ask him to ask for forgiveness for her, he said to me no. And then the Quran revealed about this. Quran says, from the Quran, it's not for a believer or a disbeliever, ask forgiveness for a disbeliever.
When it becomes
clear. He has given, now note his logic and note his sense of rationale.
showing now that these individuals, i.e. as the Prophet, the brother brought the ayat, which is specific now. Do you understand? It's specific text. Showing that it's not permissible for you and the believers. The Prophet, Allah himself, first to the Prophet himself, to ask forgiveness for those whom it is clear to you that they are disbelievers. And then Allah goes on to say, and that the asking of Ibrahim alayhi salam for his father was only for him and only particular for him. And that on Yawm al-Qiyamah, Ibrahim alayhi salam himself would distance himself from his father. And his father would turn into his father. The hadith says that Ibrahim alayhi salam would ask Allah, "Oh Allah, don't disgrace me on this day by sending my father into the hellfire." And Allah would say to him, "Oh Ibrahim alayhi salam, look to your side." And he would turn and we'll see a blood-stained hyena. And this blood-stained hyena will be caught and dragged and thrown into the hellfire. So this is the situation of Ibrahim alayhi salam, the Khalil of Ar-Rahman, the intimate friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if this is what happened with Ibrahim alayhi salam, who is one of the five established prophets, and also with Nuh alayhi salam, his son, Allah admonished Nuh alayhi salam for asking guidance upon, for asking forgiveness for his son. When his son disobeyed Nuh alayhi salam by not accepting him, when Allah admonished him and said, "I admonish you for you asking that which you do not know." And then Nuh alayhi salam turned back to him and said, "Oh Allah, forgive me for I do not wish to be from the zalimun, from the oppressors." So it's clear. It's clear that whoever does not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or whoever does not testify from the Sharia perspective, does not accept the Shahada, then from the Sharia point of view, and this is what my brother fails to understand this concept. He fails to understand this concept that the Sharia from each individual messenger may differ from one to another. As Isa alayhi salam, when he came to his people, he said, "Oh Isa, I've been sent as a messenger to you, permitting some of the commands which have been prohibited to you before." So Isa alayhi salam shows that the Sharia of Isa alayhi salam is different from the Sharia of Muhammad salam. And if the Sharia of Muhammad salam is different from the Sharia of Musa alayhi salam, or different from the Sharia of Adam alayhi salam.
Hold on.
Oh. But as regards issues of Aqidah, belief, then from Adam to the last of them is one and the same. There is no difference in the belief of Allah. There is no difference in the belief of the messenger or in the belief of the book, etc., etc. There is no difference. And this issue of a Muslim entering in, this is an issue of Iman. This is an issue of Aqidah. So the Aqidah stays the same. As regards the Sharia, when the Prophet said, as regards the incest, then we say, yes, regard that issue, that's an issue of Sharia, which differs, as Allah says, with respect to a manhaj and a way, with respect to a law and a manhaj to each amongst you. So this goes to show that the Sharia can differ from one person, from one Nabi or from one Rasul to the next. But as regards the issues of Aqidah, then the belief of Adam alayhi salam is the belief of Muhammad salam, right up till today. And the issue of Iman is one and the same. So regarding the issue of accepting or entering into Islam, then each individual messenger, when they came, each person for them to be accepted into that religion had to testify. This is the reason, as the Prophet said, the reason that this ruling of Islam or Muslim is based upon. For us, for Allah has made it that the reason that I give this brother here salam, this is the reason why I take this brother as my Muslim brother, why his blood is halal, is haram for me, his property is haram for me, his whole issue is haram for me, is because he testified, as the Prophet said, I've been ordered to fight the people until they testify that La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and then after that the blood is haram for me, the property is haram for me, except that which Allah, and the honor is haram for me, except that which Allah has legislated. So this is the issue, my dear brothers. I haven't finished. This is the issue, my dear brothers. This is the issue that we have to understand our sources. We have to understand our sources. And first and foremost is the Quran and the Sunnah. Nobody can bring us a delay, a text from outside from these two things. And then to understand this, and this is what the Prophet was asking him, to understand this, we go to the understanding of the Salaf al-Salih, the first three generations. And there is not one text. The Prophet knows this. That's why I can't answer the Prophet's question. There is not one text to show that Ibn Mas'ud or Umar or any of them of the companions or the Salaf al-Salih ever went to the grave and asked the Prophet while he was in his grave. While he was in his grave, intercession, or to ask Allah, or to bring rain, etc. There is not one narration. And I challenge him to try and go and find one. He will never find one. So this is the issue. And as regards the Prophet's father and mother, they were kafirs. Whether you like it or not. Whether you accept it or reject it. That's the fact.
These brothers declared in the beginning that they are not scholar, and as a Muslim who is not a scholar, how they can declare somebody as a kafir? Because as a Muslim,
the issue of declaring somebody a kafir, or making takfir, should I say? Throwing somebody outside from the fold of Islam, you only do two.
But this applies now.
Listen, brother, this is what I'm trying to say. You have to understand certain things first and foremost. If you don't understand this foundation, then whatever comes up top, you'll be at a loss. That's what I'm trying to say. Let me finish, brother. Now it's upon all of us now to try and seek knowledge of the Quran and the Sunnah as understood by the Salaf. That's the first thing. And to understand certain principles and foundations of our religion. The certain principles and foundations, which if we don't understand, our religion is crumbling. And from one of these things is that we do not judge anybody apart from the Sharia that Allah has legislated.
But in Sharia, you are not allowed.
And the Sharia, every ruling of the Sharia is based on the reason which is apparent and established, not for what is hidden. Do you understand? We don't judge a person's Islam by what's in his heart. We don't judge a person. If not, why did the Prophet, when the Munafiqs, he knew who the Munafiqs were. He knew. Allah revealed to him who the Munafiqs were. But did you see the Prophet's friends and chopping his head? They're kafirs. The Munafiqs would stay in the hellfire forever. Allah says in the Quran, and the Munafiqs would be assigned to the most grievous of punishment, the lowest death of the hellfire. This is where the Munafiqs reside. The Prophet knew who the Munafiqs were in Medina. Did he go about now saying chopping their heads off? No. Why? Because he has to judge them according to what is apparent and manifest, not according to what is hidden. So do you understand what I'm saying? So the Sharia, as we deal with Abdullah and with Amina, the father and mother of the Prophet, we have to deal with them on what is apparent. This is what the Sharia has given us.
You are not a prophet, you are not a scholar, you are not a wali, nothing. You're just a human being like me, and you have no right to say anything about somebody else to declare him as a kafir.
Logic has no place. Excuse me, brothers and sisters. logic or intellect over and above the Quran and Sunnah. We do not place Do you know why we don't place common sense and intellect over and above the Quran? Because of the statement of Ali. When Ali said, if this deen, if this religion was based on our intellect, based on common sense, who was underneath the hook rather than on top of it? So this shows that this intellect, is this religion is not based on our intellect. Our common sense dictates that the Prophet's father was a Muslim. Where did you get it from?
Let me respond very quickly. That it's not he who's got the loudest voice win. It's he who has the point. And Now, I must, as your evidence, okay? He's asked a question. On his question, because you asserted, you've put some evidence. I've refuted your evidence. I want to recap to you what the basis of your reputation is, okay? Now, I said to you very simple, the question was very simple. You say that he's kafir. I said, bring the evidence that he's kafir. Your evidence was this, that the Prophet said, don't worry, my father's going to be in hell. Now, does it mean from the fact that somebody is in hell, he's therefore a kafir? Does it mean that?
No.
Because it means tomorrow, no, I hope this doesn't happen, but if you go to hell tomorrow, does that mean that you're a kafir?
No, that's not sin.
Yeah. So the fact of the matter is, we will be judged according to our sins and we will go to hell according to our deeds. Now, simply to make this assumption that because the Prophet's father was a kafir, therefore he will be in Jahannam, this is not an assumption which you are entitled to make unless you have a clear evidence of the act of his shirk. I invited you and the world of Salafiyyah to show me an act of shirk which Abdullah or Sayyida Amina did. No, let me talk now. Now, the fact of the matter is you could not bring that. The only evidence you could bring was that the Prophet said, well, they're going to be in Jahannam. Does it mean that every Jahannam is a kafir? The answer is no. The fact of the matter is that everybody will be judged according to their deeds. Now, as far as what he said, he said a lot of things, but really the only thing that really was of sense that he said, and he did say some good things, which I appreciate. What he said was that Sharia, the fiqh, what he was trying to say, because he's not a scholar, he doesn't know how to classify terminology. There is a difference between fiqh and there's a difference between aqidah. Fiqh changes in every generation, right? It changes in every generation. Your fiqh even may be different to my fiqh. But our fiqh is according to our understanding of the Quran and Hadith. You may do Amin bil Jahar, you may do Rafa'i then, I don't. The fact of the matter is fiqh is variable, okay? As long as the essential spirit of fiqh is in alignment with the aqidah, okay? So that's what he was trying to say, was that Sharia changes.
Don't interpret my words.
You were saying Sharia changes, but Iman does not change. That's what you were saying. That are your words. But actually, that's not the way ulama discuss. No, ulama would say fiqh changes in accordance with the needs of the time, but the Iman will always remain the same. So therefore, the Iman of Adam alayhi salam was the same Iman of the last person who will have Iman on the Day of Judgment. So what is the common trait between the Iman of Adam alayhi salam or the Ummah of Adam alayhi salam and the Iman of the person who exists near the Day of Judgment? What is the common facet of Iman? Is the common facet of Iman belief in messenger
No, because the messenger at the time of Adam alayhi salam was different, and the messenger for the person close to the judgment is different. Why? Because for him, his messenger is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and for the person in the ummah of the Adam alayhi salam, his prophet is Adam alayhi salam. So iman, the common trait of iman is la ilaha illallah. That is the common trait of iman. Nobody can enter iman unless he does not accept this assertion. I presented you a hadith where the Prophet ﷺ said, "Man qala la ilaha illallah fadkhulul jannah." You know that a kafir can't enter Jannah, but a Muslim can enter Jahannam. True? So the Prophet said, he who says la ilaha illallah, he will go to Jannah. So kafirs can never go to Jannah, but Mu'min can go to Jahannam. The fact of the matter is that those people who came at a time that there was no Prophet there, in their time, they will be judged according to their deeds. But as far as their iman is concerned, if they believed in La ilaha illallah, they are, as a matter of Sharia, Muslims. We cannot call them kafir. Simply to present the hadith that they are kafirs because they're going to Jahannam, that's not a good hadith. Why? You are giving takfir to the parents of the Prophet ﷺ. What he is saying is that no, it's a general thing, you can apply to everyone. Here we're not talking about general, we're talking about specific people. We're talking about the family of the Prophet ﷺ. We are talking about the father and the mother of the Prophet ﷺ. Now, if you can show me that the Prophet's father and the Prophet's mother committed an act of shirk, show me in the Salafus Salihin's statements or in the Ahadith, show me the act of shirk. And if you cannot show me, then it means that you must be cautious in saying that they are kafir. Why? Yes, as far as Jahannam is concerned, you may go to Jahannam, I may go to Jahannam, but it doesn't mean to say that we are no longer Muslims. The fact that a person goes to Jahannam is based on his deeds. The fact of the matter is, the Prophet's parents, we do not have the authority or the right, unless the Hadith literature gives us evidence that Abdullah and Amina committed shirk. Unless we do not have evidence of that, we cannot call them kafir.
On the principle, we claim that Sharia is not like the fiqh.
No,
we're not saying. Alright. So he's saying that Sharia is something different. So he's saying that in Quran refused him. He says Allah, لِكُلِّ مِنْكُمْ جَعَلْنَا شِرَعَةً وَمِنْهَاجًا. Shira, the word Shira is the root word of Sharia. Allah said, for every one of you, we make a Shira, we make a Sharia, وَمِنْهَاج, and a way. So that means that the Sharia of each prophet was different. The Sharia which has been revealed to Musa, to the Jews, is different from the Sharia has been revealed to Isa. They are different Sharia. But the point of reading is the belief, the Aqidah. All of them they believe on the oneness of Allah. All of them they believe the angel. That's the Aqidah, they're not very different about it. No one of the prophets said, this is the son for Allah. Isa, he didn't claim this. Musa, he didn't claim this. All in the case is only one God. But in the ruling of the dealing, marriage, eating, the way of prayer, all of this dealing was being different. That's the Sharia. That means Sharia. And the fiqh is one of the issues under the Sharia. And the fiqh is one of the issues of the Sharia. And that's how to show this brother. Is he claiming that we don't know this knowledge? Alhamdulillah, we're not praising ourselves saying we are knowledgeable, we are ulama, as some people do. No, we bring what we know, alhamdulillah, we say this is how the people classify his deen. So there is the Sharia and there is the Aqidah, and under the Sharia there is the Iman. And the Sharia, sorry, there is the Fiqh. That's the first point. The second point he's raising, saying to me that we shouldn't use the general text specifically on the Prophet's parents. We say to him, generally, by the people of Usul, people of the principles, people of the ulama, from the past till our time, no one of them, he says, that's just a general rule, which is known by all the ulama of the scholars, and you know this, inshallah, that whenever there is a general text, whenever there is a general text in the Quran and in the Sunnah, you cannot say to me now, it is applicable for every people under that general text, and you cannot take them out of it, except by bringing proof that they are specified out of it. That's the ruling of the Aam and Khas, general and specific. Whenever there's something general, so if you say all the people Our Muslim, meaning our Muslim, I can't declare them kafir unless they bring a proof. So and so is kafir. And the same, if I say the people aren't kafir, I can't declare them Muslim unless I bring the proof. Okay. First of all, Prophet he said, I have been ordered to fight the people, meaning he fights them because they're kafir, he fights them because they're kafir, until they say, La ilaha Allah. That's the justification taken out from the generality. They say, La ilaha Allah, this is taken out from the generality. Now, so we need to prove that this Abdullah said La ilaha Allah, no. This Amina said La ilaha Allah, no. That's from the family of the Muhammad, yes, yeah, we agree. There's no emotion in Sharia. Again, Abdul Muttalib, the father of Abdullah, he's the grandfather of Messenger. How are we saying he's a kafir? Yes, he's a kafir. He's a kafir because, again, he's the grandfather of Allah. Because by saying he's the grandfather of the Muhammad, he will never be a kafir. We go to the chain back to all the mushrik, to the Bab Adam. All of them are from the chain of Muhammad. So we shouldn't say that they are kafir. No, not the case. Because the word Ahlul Bayt applies for whom? Apply for the generation of Muhammad, not before him. And that's the meaning of Ahlul Bayt. That's the meaning of Hassan, Hussein, Fatima, Khadija, Aisha, all this is Ahlul Bayt. This is the people of his family, Ahlul Bayt. People of his family. And that's the meaning of Hassan. That means Adam, that meaning Amina and Abdullah, they have never said the word of La ilaha illallah, so we can't say they are Muslims. We cannot say they are Muslims. And that's the same with Abu Lahab, Abu Jahl, Abdul Muttalib. And the second hadith of Abdul Muttalib, when the Prophet came to him, he supported the Muslims. He sheltered them, the uncle of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He sheltered them, he helped them. He used to provide them with everything. And he used to be the leader of Quraysh. When he's dying, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to him and he said to him, Oh my uncle, say one word. I can use it to intercede for you. Say La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. He said, I can't say it, I need the religion of my family, my people. And he said, he died as a kafir, and he's in hellfire. And he is receiving the lowest level of the punishment, where his head is boiling because of the fire under his feet. So again, uncle of prophet, how will I say uncle of prophet is dying as a kafir? There's a proof. And that's understanding of the general text and system from those things.
Now. Firstly, the general and the khas and the arm.
Allah,
camera.
سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله